boa noite a vocês. Boa noite em especial ao pessoal do direito, que veio, e ao Gabriel, que trouxe a turma dele. Acho que vai ser bem interessante. Eu estou falando em português, mas em seguida eu vou falar em inglês, porque essa conferência será em inglês e sem tradução. Mas eu queria dar as boas-vindas aos estudantes que vieram e agradecer a presença deles em português. E dizer que no momento das perguntas, aqueles que não puderem fazer a pergunta em inglês, por favor, nos peçam ajuda, a gente faça a tradução para vocês. Então, não deixe de participar porque não pode fazer a pergunta em inglês. Ok? It's a good evening. It's our pleasure to receive this night Professor Patrick Haggard, which is one of the most distinguished neurocognitive scientists in the UK. He works at the Institute of Cognitive Neuroscience at the University College London, which is part of the University of London. Patrick came a long way, and I thank him very, very much for doing this. To be with us, he will give this talk tonight and will work with our group tomorrow and on Monday. And so thank you so much for taking your time to come to work with us. He's also very well informed. He has a background in psychology, is trained in psychology, but is very well informed in philosophical questions, so which make his talk very, very interesting for us. And Barry Smith, as I said the first day, the director of the Institute of Philosophy, helped us financially to bring Patrick Haggard here, so I thank you, Barry, again for doing this. And to help us to put this conference together, it's very difficult to finance science these days in Brazil, so to have this partnership was fantastic. So thank you both. And without further ado, I will hand the mic to Patrick. He will talk around 50 minutes or so, and we'll have time for questions. So I'll enjoy the talk, and it's with you, Patrick.
Hello, everybody. Hello. Am I talking too loud, too quiet?
Fine.
About okay. So the people at the back, you can make a sign like this or like this, depending on what I do. So you are a very important person. Well, thank you very much, Adriana. It was a very nice invitation. It's a real pleasure to be here. I am very impressed to find so many people spending the evening listening to talk about the sense of agency. So thank you all for spending your time. And I'd like to begin by thanking all of the collaborators who have actually done all this work. So science is a group activity. I am an experimental scientist. I collect data about human behavior and human cognition. And in fact, I do not have the data. I have many people who help me to collect this. So this is a group project. So my talk today is about the sense of agency in humans. So I should begin by making clear what the sense of agency means. All right. Closer. Okay, thank you. So the sense of agency refers to the feeling that we have of controlling our own actions. It is related to voluntariness, it is related to free will, it is part of the normal, healthy adult experience that you can do whatever you want. And this begins particularly with body movement. So one of the unique features of our mental life is that we can make movements at will. So Wittgenstein famously asked, what is the difference between the fact that my arm goes up and the fact that I raise my arm? And one obvious difference is that I can move my arm at will, and I feel a particular experience of controlling my body movements. And that's really what sense of agency is about. And I think it's important, I think it's a key part of our mental lives, and I think it's a brain mechanism which we can study, as I hope I will show you. When we think about actions in psychology and in fact also in philosophy, we use a very simple framework like this, where we propose that actions begin with an intention. In philosophy, you often use the very difficult word reason. People have reasons for action. That always makes me very frightened. We prefer to talk about intentions. So I intend to lift my arm moves, and normally I move my arm for some to produce some effect, to produce some outcome. I don't move my arm just to illustrate Wittgenstein. I move my arm, for example, to reach, to collect something from a shelf, or to press a button. So our actions are very often instrumental. They have effects on our environment. And this is a really striking feature of human action. Human action really changes the world. We construct our own environment. If you look around you now, you do not see anything natural. Maybe the people are natural, but the table, the computer, the chairs, the lights, everything is man-made. It's all a product of human agency, and I'm interested in that sense of agency. So we distinguish two components in agency. In this process, we use the term volition to refer to the process of turning your intentions into movements. So that's, if you like, will, or free will, if you believe in free will. And we use the more restricted term agency to mean understanding the relationship between what I do and what happens. So understanding that when I press the button on the mouse, the slide will change. That's agency. There's a relation between what I do and what happens. Now, agency is really important because it is the basis of our notion of responsibility. Okay? So I think that you are responsible for what you do. If you do something bad, then I will blame you and I will punish you. And this is really based on a model that you know what you're doing and that I know what you're doing, and that you have a relation between your movements and the effects of your movements. So the law makes a strong use of the idea of sense of agency, and we'll talk about that more in a minute. But also I think technology is very, very strongly based on agency. So one interesting thing about the human brain is that we can work with completely arbitrary relations between intentions, movements and effects. So we can use machines which allow us to have effects at a distance. I can make an action here and I know what will happen on the screen. So if I move the mouse, I'll see a result on the screen. So technology is extremely important. We'll come on to psychiatry later. Now I want to just read a quote from a book about agency. One problem with agency is it is ubiquitous in our lives. All of our life we are doing things and making things happen. We have so much agency we do not see it. It's like air that we breathe. And this is a person who had very little agency at all because he is paralyzed. And the only part of his body that he can move is his left foot. And he can remember at age 7 when he first used his left foot to do something, to change his world. So he can remember not having agency and then having agency. And he can remember how it transformed his life. Suddenly, I wanted desperately to do what my sister was doing. My sister was drawing. Then, without thinking or knowing exactly what I was doing, I reached out and took the stick of chalk, pencil, out of my sister's hand with my left foot. I held it tightly between my toes and, acting on an impulse, I made a wild sort of scribble with it on the slate. Now, he does not in fact know why he does this, but look at how important the experience is. This is the first time that he ever has the feeling that he can do something. And we have that feeling, if we are lucky, all of our lives, so we don't realize how important that feeling is. So the point there is that our sense of agency is always there. It's in the background of our lives, and it is rarely something that we think about directly. And you can see that in development, we must discover the sense of agency. If you look at a newborn baby, 1 or 2 days old, they are just making random movements. They cannot do anything, or not anything very useful. So in our development in early childhood, we learn to control our bodies, and we learn to do things with our bodies, and we have all forgotten. He has not forgotten, because he did not learn until age 7. But all of us have forgotten this development of agency. Okay, so now let's talk a little bit about the law, and let's just talk about how sense of agency is an important assumption of society. Society only works because I think I have a sense of agency, and I think you have a sense of agency. So this man is Sir Robert Peel, and Sir Robert Peel was the Prime Minister of Great Britain in about 1830-something, about 200 years ago. And he looks very like David Cameron. They are not related, but they look very similar, and they were both right-wing prime ministers. So there is some, maybe, genetic component. So Peel was the prime minister, and this man was called Daniel McNaughton. And Daniel McNaughton was mad. We would now say he was a paranoid schizophrenic. And he decided that he had to kill Peel. And he tried to shoot Peel with a gun, but he shot somebody else. He didn't shoot Peel, he shot one of Peel's assistants and killed him. And during the trial, it was clear that McNaughton was not acting, thinking, like other people do. He was insane. And there was a long debate about how can the law deal with people who don't understand their own actions. Why is he doing this? What is his experience of this action of shooting this man? So the legal system in England, it is very funny. And the ultimate legal decision comes from a group of aristocrats called the House of Lords. And nobody knows why, but they make all the ultimate moral decisions. So they had to ask, what must we assume to hold somebody responsible for their actions? And they wrote a document called the McNaughton Rules, which are still used in Britain many, many, many years later, to decide whether somebody is insane. And I will try and read it. It's quite difficult English. It's very old-fashioned and very confusing, and that's the problem of law. So if somebody, at the time of the committing of the act, the person, was laboring under such a defect of reason from disease of the mind as not to know the nature and quality of the act he was doing, or if he did know it, he did not know he was doing what was wrong. So what they're saying is that the law can work with people who know the nature and quality of the act. If I do something, if I shoot somebody or I move my arm, and I just say, I do not know what I'm doing, I do not have the subjective experience of controlling this movement, then in an English court, I will not be guilty, I will be insane. Not guilty, but insane. And what that means is, instead of going to prison, I will go to a psychiatric unit. Now, the reason why this is important is it shows that the law assumes that we all know what we're doing. We all understand the nature and quality of our actions. And I find that interesting because it is a psychological assertion. The law thinks, or the law needs you to have a particular kind of psychology so that you know when you lift your arm, when you pull the trigger on the gun, all of the things that you can do, you have to have sense of agency. So what I'm going to try and do in the next 30 minutes or so is talk a little bit about how you might approach this experience of agency scientifically. How can we study it? It's clearly important. Our society is based on a shared assumption that we all have sense of agency, but what is it? How can we study it? So the key thing for me is always measuring experience. Psychology is the discipline which tries to quantify and measure human experiences. So I will spend quite a long time describing my own work in which I've been trying to measure the experience of agency. And then we will have time, I hope, to talk about the mechanisms in the brain that allow us to perceive our agency. And we'll also talk about some more cognitive processes, because I think there are some cognitive science people here, about how we associate actions to produce agency. Right, so if you just ask people about agency, if you ask an explicit question, did you do that? You cannot trust their answer. Because suppose the action in question is somebody hitting somebody, or somebody shooting somebody, or somebody doing something wrong. If you ask them, did you do that, they will probably say no, even if they did it. People tell stories about agency. So we need some way to measure the sense of agency indirectly. And in psychology, we use the phrase implicit measures. So rather than directly asking you about your experience of what you're doing, we're going to try to understand it in a way which does not require you to report it directly. And that means you cannot cheat. You can't tell me what you think you should say. You have to actually describe your experience. And we do this through time perception. So an interesting feature in psychology developed as an experimental science in the 19th century, and the key finding, in fact, came from physiology. It came from Helmholtz, who discovered that the activity of the neuron in the brain and in the spinal cord takes measurable time. Psychological processes, thinking, takes time, and you can measure how long it takes, and measuring time is important for understanding psychological processing. So what this means is, in psychology, if you cannot think of a good question, then when is always a very good question to ask. Time perception tells us a lot about what the experience is. So I've been working within the area or the method within psychology, which is called mental chronometry. So it's asking when questions about experiences. Many of you may recognize here the Libet experiment. This is the same method as the Libet experiment, but Libet was interested in free will. I'm not interested in free will tonight. I'm interested in the feeling of controlling your actions and events in the outside world. But the method is the same. So a mental chronometry experiment has two parts. The first part is you have a clock, and it's a quite funny clock because it's only got one hand, and the hand goes round every 2.5 seconds. And the clock is just there for you to report when you have an experience. When do you do something, or see something, or hear something? So the clock is like the ruler, it's a measurement device. And the second part of the experiment is that the person will make a voluntary action. So in these experiments that I will tell you about, it's always the same. They're going to press on a button like this. So there's the clock going round, there's the person deciding to press the button. There we go. And this action is a voluntary action. So what this means is that they press the button when they feel like it, when you want to. I don't tell you when to press the button. You decide when to press the button. The clock hand stops in a random location, and then we can ask the person, where was the clock hand when you pressed the button? So in this case, the person might say, well, I think I pressed the button when the clock was at 23. And I know that, in fact, they pressed the button when the clock was at 25, and I know how fast the clock is going, so I can measure the time of their experience of their own action relative to the physical reality of their action. Okay? So I can measure when they experience their action. Now, we're using this mental chronometry to study an effect which I think gives us a new way of measuring feeling of agency, the sense of agency. And we call this effect intentional binding, which is a silly, funny name, and I'll explain it. Maybe you'll see why it's called that. Intentional binding is an idea which David Hume, the philosopher, would have been very happy with. It is the idea that when we make an action which produces an outcome, We experience the action and the outcome as linked together in time. We associate what we do with what happens. That is the sense of agency, and it changes our time perception. Let me describe in detail how the experiment works, because for me, the art of doing the experiment and getting all the conditions of the experiment correct is an important part of the conceptual analysis. So we start off with a series of trials where the person is just watching this clock going round and round and round, and they are not making any actions, but at a random time they hear a beep. So the computer just goes beep. And we ask the person, where was the clock when you heard the beep? So we know when the beep occurred, and we know when the person has an experience, an awareness of the beep. And they're not the same. And interestingly, people often think they heard the beep before it actually happened, which is quite surprising. But the critical thing that we're going to do is we will have another session, another part of the experiment, where we say, please press the button when you feel like it. Please make the action. And your action will cause this beep. So you are making the beep. The beep is now the effect of your action. And the important part of the logic of the experiment is that we can compare the perceived time of a beep, which happens all by itself, with the perceived time of a beep, which is caused by my own action. And what we find is that the beep is perceived to shift earlier in time towards the action that I made to cause it. So because I pressed the button and I made this beep happen, I experience the beep as shifting towards the action. Everybody happy? I can see some people nodding. That's good. So there's a change in the timing of my experience because I did it, because I'm the agent. Now we can do the same thing on the action side. So we have one session of the experiment where you press the button and there is no beep. And we can say, where was the clock hand when you think you pressed the button? So that's this awareness of the action here in red. And we can compare that to the awareness of exactly the same action which causes a beep. And you find a shift in the awareness of the action relative to this baseline when the action causes the beep. So if we put those two results together, in reality, action and beep are separated by 250 milliseconds. This is all very short, all very quick, because human actions are very quick. And we can use the baseline estimates of the action and the beep alone to look at the shift of the action towards the beep and the shift of the beep back towards the action. So you can see that my experience of my own action and outcome is compressed, it's linked. We use the phrase binding. Now the really interesting thing is you only get this if you decide to press the button. You only get this for intentional actions. You only get this for things that you do and for things that you decide to do. And the critical control condition comes from a very, very beautiful tool called transcranial magnetic stimulation. So this was me when I was young, and this was my postdoc when he was young, and he's stimulating my brain with a magnetic field, and he can make my body move without will, without intention, involuntarily. And just because I think you are not neuroscientists here, I would like to show you a 1-minute video which explains the technique so that you will understand this idea of movement without will. It is quite remarkable. So I'm going to just escape from this. So the coil here is over the left hemisphere motor cortex and the hand area, which will make my right hand move. And that is when she discharges the magnetic field. She presses the machine and the magnetic field is very brief but very strong. And it produces electrical activity in my neurons. And the electrical activity is conducted across to the opposite side of the spinal cord. Look at my hand. You get a little twitch. Well, that's not me, that is her with her machine, not me. So these are the same muscles that I would use to press the button, but it is not will, it is an involuntary movement. And we can measure the involuntary movement directly from the muscle with electrodes. And we can measure how the brain is connecting to the muscle by looking at the size of the muscle twitch that is evoked and the delay of the muscle twitch. So I think this is an absolutely beautiful tool, because you could make people move without them wanting to move. And when you have this, if you have this experience for the first time, it is very, very bizarre. You look at your hand and it twitches. And just the strangeness of this experience teaches me that we are very, very familiar with our own agency, that we assume agency, and we don't really have a non-agency to compare it with. So now I will go back to intentional binding. So I've shown you before that you get this binding or perceptual compression of action and effect for voluntary actions. This is the same data where now, instead of making a voluntary action, I have this involuntary TMS-induced twitch, which again is followed by a beep 250 milliseconds later. So in this TMS case, there is no volition, there's no will, and the brain does not associate the action and the outcome. It keeps them apart. You can see that, in fact, there is a shift of the twitch away from the beep and of the beep away from the twitch. So what this suggests is that it's something about my volition which is causing the experience of action and outcome being linked together. There's something predictive about the whole process. This is not a natural consequence of any two events, it's only voluntary actions. Okay, so I'm going to take a few moments to discuss how might this be happening in the brain and what does it do, what is the mechanism and what does it tell us about our own actions. Okay, so very often in cognitive neuroscience, the real progress comes if you can have a subjective experience and a brain mechanism. So if you can understand part of our mental life and also understand what is the machinery in the brain which generates this part of our mental life. So we tried to do this for the intentional binding effect that I just explained. Now, here we have 9 patients with Parkinson's disease. So you probably all know somebody with Parkinson's disease. Parkinson's disease is a degenerative condition due to a loss of dopamine neurotransmitter, okay? And the important point for us about Parkinson's disease is it makes people slow. They have not much action. Their action level reduces. They walk slowly. They stop making facial expressions. So their face is like that. So it's a very difficult disease. And we took a small group of Parkinson's patients and we compared them to healthy controls. So here are healthy controls, aged about 60, and they show a shift in the perceived time of action towards the beep and a shift in the perceived time of the beep back towards the action. And so exactly did the Parkinson's patients. They show exactly the same kinds of changes in time perception for their own actions as you and I do. Now, the interesting thing about these Parkinson's patients is they are not taking their drug. The standard treatment for early Parkinson's is to give dopamine therapy. So the doctor prescribes a form of dopamine which will increase the availability of this chemical in the brain. And that helps the patients move, it helps them just to get on with their lives. And what we've done here is we've tested them off their medication. So we ask them not to take the last dopamine tablet when they go to bed, not to take the first dopamine tablet when they wake up in the morning, to come to the hospital and to do the experiment. So they're not on dopamine, and they're very Parkinsonian, they're slow, they're rigid, they're not very good. Then we give them their dopamine tablet, and 20 minutes later, they are active and moving and smiling and much, much more active. Their agency is restored. And we get them to do the same experiment again on dopamine, and we find stronger binding of the action towards the beat, and stronger binding of the beat back towards the action. They, in both cases, they're pressing the button and hearing the beat, but when they're on dopamine, they experience these two things as very strongly linked together. They have an increased sense of agency. They have a stronger perception of, I made that beat, I can do that. So there's no effect of the disease, but there's a very strong effect of the drug. So dopamine is a key system for giving us the experience of agency. The second thing I want to do is to pursue this idea that somehow voluntariness is important for experiencing the sense of agency. This is not my data. This is data from Itzhak Fried, who is a neurosurgeon working in Los Angeles in the United States. And he is one of the very, very few people who can directly stimulate the human brain inside the head. So we stimulate it from outside with a magnetic field. He stimulates it inside. He is a neurosurgeon, and he is treating patients who have severe epilepsy. And when patients have severe epilepsy, sometimes they cannot be treated with drugs, and then they are treated with a brain operation where the damaged part of the brain is removed, it's cut out. But before he cuts the brain, he checks carefully to see which bit should I cut. And the way they do that is they put grids of electrodes in the brain. And here, they're putting a strip of electrodes, electrical contacts, in the fissure between the two hemispheres, down in the gap between the two hemispheres in the frontal part of the brain, which is the bit of the brain that is involved in planning and decision and in those kinds of complex cognitive activities. Now, when he, and during this time, he can stimulate, he can put electricity into different bits of the brain through these electrodes. And the patient is completely awake. The patient is fully conscious. They're just sitting in a chair, like you are now. And the patient is observed, and they're invited to say what they feel. So if you stimulate the visual brain, the patient will say, I see something. And if you stimulate the auditory brain, the patient will say, I hear a noise. And you can artificially create all of these experiences by direct brain stimulation. Very, very, very powerful technique. Now, when Fried stimulated in this region here, in the frontal lobes, which is one of the main targets of dopamine, interestingly, the patient would say things like, I have an urge to move my right arm. Now, this word urge is a very funny word in English. It's probably even more funny in Portuguese. The word urge is strongly used in Freudian psychology to mean all of those things that we want to do but we shouldn't. And I don't know, I've not had this experience, so I don't know what this urge is. But the patient describes an experience like wanting, like being driven to, like being about to. And there are two important points. First of all, the neurosurgeon has given that experience to the patient. It is not free will, right? The patient doesn't decide to lift their right arm. The doctor makes the patient feel like they want to lift their right arm. And the other thing which is very important is the patient has not actually moved. The patient is sitting completely still. They haven't actually moved their right arm. They just feel they want to. So this really gives the impression that in the frontal cortex there is some volitional signal, some signal about the action that we will make soon. Not yet, but soon. Preparation. Now, interestingly, if you switch up the current, so you stimulate it 20 milliampere instead of 10 milliampere, then the person actually moves, and they normally move the same part of the body, the right arm in this case, that they previously said they had an urge to move. So what this means is that the experience of urge, of volition, is part of the mechanism for making my body move. It's on the main pathway. Okay, I think for reasons of time, we will switch that. We'll skip that. And you've gathered already that I like stimulating the brain, because I have described already two brain stimulation tracts, and now I want to describe a third one. Why do I like stimulating the brain? Well, when you stimulate the system, you are working like an engineer. So an engineer tries to understand the system by treating the system like a black box, controlling the input and measuring the output. They call it system identification. And we can do the same with the human mind, with the human brain, when we can provide a stimulus and measure the response. Now, in psychology, the easy way to provide a stimulus is through the eyes or through the ears. It's using something like a flash or a beep. But when you're studying action, what is the input to your action? The input to your action is something which is inside your head. I cannot really control what you do. So that's why we stimulate the brain mechanism, because it gives us a way to actually intervene causally on the human mind. So we've been studying a method called transcranial direct current stimulation. It's another kind of electrical stimulation of the brain. And effectively, it is just like taking a 9-volt battery and connecting the two poles of the battery across your scalp. I suggest you do not do that, because you can burn your skin. You will not damage your brain, but you will damage your skin. So what we do is we place these electrical contacts on specific parts of the brain, and we can pass a precisely controlled current across them, which will go through the underlying brain tissue. So here we're going to pass a current from the left frontal to the right prefrontal cortex, and we'll stimulate all of this area in between. Here we're going to stimulate the parietal cortex at the back of the brain, and we always have to have a sham condition, control condition. This is really, really important. If the participant knows that their brain is being stimulated, then first of all they will be scared, they will be frightened, and we don't want that, but also they will have like a placebo effect. They will start to do things a little bit different because they will think that we are stimulating their brain. So we always have a sham condition where we actually start the stimulation. So for about 20 seconds, the person feels a funny tingling sensation in the skin under the electrodes. And then we very gradually switch the stimulation off, and the person does not know. So we are stimulating for 20 minutes, and 20 seconds. And it feels exactly the same to the participant. And during this 20-minute period of stimulation, we can do the intentional binding experiment, and we can try to measure your sense of agency by looking at the perceived time of actions and effects. So this is a kind of graph that you've seen many times before. In reality, the person makes an action, which is followed 250 milliseconds later by a beep. And in the sham condition, we compare the perceived time of action to a baseline where you have actions without beeps, and the perceived time of the beep to a baseline where you have beeps without actions, and we get beautiful binding of action towards beep. We get the same perceptual compression, this feeling that what I do and what happens are very tightly linked in time. Now, it's quite interesting. This experiment was done last year. Our first experiments were done 15 years ago, and these binding effects are much, much bigger than the first ones that we got 15 years ago. So over time, this effect is getting bigger. This is the
I don't quite know why. I'm a little bit worried about that, but maybe people are reading my papers. But the important point is to look at the brain stimulation. So I want to draw your attention really just to this condition where we're stimulating the parietal cortex. So when we stimulate the parietal cortex, we get a little bit of binding of the action towards the beat, and a little bit of binding of the beat back towards the action, but much, much, much less than in the sham condition where we are not actually passing any current through the brain. Now, it turns out that the parietal cortex, just underneath this electrode here, contains a structure called the angular gyrus. And the angular gyrus is active in brain imaging experiments whenever something external happens, whenever there is the experience that that's not me, I didn't do that, something funny is going on. So the angular gyrus seems to be a brain area which detects the departure from the normal fluent way that we just move our bodies and we press the button and the light comes on and we control our lives. And the angular gyrus is like the alarm signal. Patrick, something's funny, you did not do that. So what's actually happening here, I think, is that the electrical stimulation from this anode here is providing an excitation, positive electrical drive to a brain area which is saying, not me, it wasn't me, I didn't do that. And that is why, when we stimulate this area, we reduce the amount of intentional binding. We reduce the tendency of the mind to link what I do with what happens. So we're stimulating the brain, but we're stimulating a kind of negative problem detection area of the brain, and we are reducing the sense of agency. So just to summarize the brain's agency network, in order to make an action, you have to use your primary motor cortex. This is the bit which produces movements if you stimulate it. But we can ask a very legitimate causal question. Where does the input come from into this area? What causes the electrical neurons in the primary motor cortex to fire? Well, it turns out there are several inputs into the primary motor cortex. From the medial frontal lobes, we have all of the signals of motivation, drive, urge, wanting, all of the signals which impel us to act. And from the lateral frontal lobes, I haven't discussed that in detail, we have the clever bit of the brain which selects, should I do this or should I do that? Do I do A or B? Do I want pizza or do I want curry? All right. So you have selection between alternatives. And then in the angular gyrus of the parietal cortex, you have some monitoring of the outcomes. Did this action succeed and produce the outcome that I intended, or did it not? Okay, in the last 5 minutes, I want to talk more about the idea from cognitive science that our brain may contain representations of different actions, different outcomes, and we may have principles for associating them. So the reason for interest in the cognitive associative mechanisms of agency is that human agency is really unlimited. We can do so many things. A rat can press a lever and get food. A dog can jump at its master and get something, but not much more than that. Our agency is almost unlimited. So for example, we can build a tool to make a tool to get something we want. We have this indirect chains of agency, which seem to be particularly relevant for human cognition. And I think one reason for that is that when we make actions, we are strongly predicting outcomes. The brain is highly predictive, and I'm going to talk a little bit about that. Now, what I've shown you in intentional binding is that you have an action which is perceived to shift towards the outcome, and an outcome which is perceived to shift back towards the action. So you can have a strongly associative interpretation of this, that the brain is linking these two representations in a Humean way. Now, if you can associate two things, then one thing allows you to predict the other. So David Hume pointed out that when you have an association, you have the possibility to predict if A, then B. Now, what I'm going to do now is I'm going to try to consider whether the binding of an action towards an outcome, that's this change in my parametric experience here, does it reflect an advanced prediction of the beat, of the tone that I will make? Or is it an a posteriori reconstruction? Do I press the button and predict the tone? Or do I wait for the tone and then say, oh, Patrick, that's your tone. You must have made that tone by pressing the button, so you should link your action towards the tone. A priori prediction or a posteriori reconstruction. Are we happy with that? Both mechanisms might contribute to my experience of controlling what I do. Do I know what I'm doing because I predict in advance what will happen, or do I know what I'm doing because I notice things happening in the world and conclude that I am the cause? So this is a little bit complicated. I'll try to take you through it gently. What we're going to do here is we're going to have a session of 40 trials where you press the button, as always, and on half of the trials at random you will hear a beep, and the other half of the trials at random you will not hear any beep. So you might make a beep or you might not. And we will compare that to, and we're going to measure the binding of the action towards the tone. We can't study the tone because on many trials the tone doesn't happen, so we only study the action. Now when we do that, what we find is that you get the binding of the action towards the beep on those, this is the value in milliseconds, the shift in milliseconds, on those trials where the beep occurs, but you get less binding, statistically less binding, when the beep doesn't happen. So what this means is that when the beep happens, people reconstruct their experience of action and they move it closer to the beep. They hear the beep, they say, oh, Patrick, you did that. So your action must be related to the beep. And they only do that if they hear the beep. Now we can compare that to a second session where the probability of the tone given the action is increased to 75%. So now, every time I press the button, I have a 75% chance of getting the beep, and only 25% of the trials without any beep. And what you find in this case is quite interesting. If you look at the binding of the action towards the beep in milliseconds, what you find is you get a shift in the perceived time of the action towards the beep when the tone occurs, but also on the 25% of trials where the tone doesn't actually happen at all. And what that means is the person is actually predicting that the tone will happen and changing their experience of what they do, of their action, based on the prediction, even though that prediction was actually wrong. So this is the predictive brain which is structuring my experience of what I'm doing and perhaps even of who I am based on what I think is going to happen. So we can define here two contrasts. Here in red, we can define reconstruction as the difference between the perceived time of actions which are or are not followed by tones. And here in blue, we can define prediction as the difference in the perceived time of actions which do not produce a tone, but probably should have, and actions which do not produce a tone and were less likely to. So it's a game of probabilities. Now, the really important thing is that you can see here on this slide is that healthy volunteers predict the consequences of their action, and that changes what they experience. Schizophrenia is a debilitating disease which psychology has always been fascinated by. The schizophrenic mind doesn't work like your mind or my mind. It doesn't obey the rules of thought. It makes strange connections. So we were able to do exactly this experiment in a group of 27 patients with schizophrenia. So these are people who might, for example, say things like, Jesus Christ is controlling my thoughts. Jesus Christ is making me do something. I am controlling you. what you're seeing on the television is what I decided that the government should put on the television. So they have a disorganized cognition of cause and effect. And when we do this experiment in schizophrenics, remember what we're doing is we're comparing the reconstructive and the predictive aspects of sense of agency measured by action marking. I'll just go straight to the sort of final result, which is shown here. What we've shown here is the specific effects of the reconstructive part of the sense of agency and the predictive or prospective part of the sense of agency, measured by the size of this binding effect, this shift in the perceived time of action in milliseconds. So the schizophrenics here are in orange, and what you can see is that they show a shift of 12 milliseconds of actions towards tones in the reconstructive condition, only when the tone actually happens. Okay? And healthy controls don't show any reconstructive components at all. If you look at the predictive or prospective component, which is the shift in the perceived time of action based on the prediction that it will occur compared to a less prediction that it will occur, you can see that the schizophrenics don't predict at all. Their experience is not at all structured by any prediction of what will happen. It's only dependent on what actually does happen. So the schizophrenic is completely surprised by the consequences of their own actions, and they only experience the control of their actions after something has happened, not when they press the button. In contrast, you and I, the healthy volunteers, have about a 14-13 millisecond shift in agency just when we predict we're going to get the tone, even if we don't get the tone. So there are two ways to feel in control. One is to predict what will happen when you lift your arm or when you press a button. The other is to press the button, hope something happens, and then think, oh my goodness, I must have done that. And if you are like that, if you're retrospective, you're constantly surprised by what you can do. And I think this is the basis for the disorganized cognition in schizophrenia, the jumping to conclusions, the misunderstanding of the relation between what I do and what happens. Now, I think I'm going to skip everything else, and I'm going to go straight to the conclusions, which are here. So I think that sense of agency is a distinctive experience of human action. I think it is always with us in healthy cognition. I think we are familiar with it like air, so we don't realize how important and how tricky it is. Most importantly, I think it can be studied scientifically. So sense of agency is something which we often say is part of subjectivity, but we can study it, we can measure it, we can actually work out where does this part of our subjective mental life come from. And the brain mechanisms underlying this experience involve some prediction and some retrospective monitoring. The front part of your brain, I think, does the prediction, and the back part does the monitoring. But not everybody agrees with me, that's my view. And I think this is a really important experience for our common humanity. So I think our capacity to perform goal-directed actions, to have goals, reasons, aims, purposes, things we want to do in our lives, I think it all depends on having this sense of agency. And I think as a society, we all work in a way where we assume that everybody has a sense of agency, so they understand what they're doing, and they're capable of acting to pursue a goal, and they're therefore responsible for what they do. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Patrick, for this very clear, didactic explanation of what you've been doing. I think even philosophers could understand very well what's going on. And many questions can be made on that theme, so it's open. We have a mic. Can you mute, please?
Thank you.
Thank you for your talk. This is a topic that I'm very interested in. So I'm going to try to ask you a question and try to make some sense of it. So from what I understand, and I read your paper where you talk a bit about this, you're contrasting a perspective on action production, or at least on sense of agency, that is contrary to what, for instance, Daniel Wegner thinks, the retrospective point of view of action, while you're saying that we predict our actions. And so I'm concerned about a few philosophical points about that. So for instance, when we produce our actions and we have this experience of control, this is at least consciousness in the sense of awareness of what we're doing. So I'm wondering whether we can, if you have studied or if there is any indication that this sense of awareness is actually relevant to the production of action. Is it causally necessary to produce the action? And there's also another question, which is a little bit outside of your topic today, but it's in the paper. I know that you and Anthony Marcel and, for instance, Pressure, you divide sense of agency into parts, for instance, sense of control and a sense of intention and the causation of action. So I was wondering if we have time, maybe you could talk just a little bit about this division.
Okay, thank you very much for your question. Regarding the first part of your question, I think Daniel Wegner, who sadly died a couple of years ago, he was definitely right that we do retrospectively understand what we have done. We do have a strong retrospective process. I'm interested that I cannot measure it with implicit measures. So I think the retrospective process is largely a self-narrative, which is a quite explicit propositional account of why I hit him in the face, or to justify. It's about justification, in my view. I think Wegner had a very strong position that that's all we have. We only have retrospection. We don't know what we're doing before we do it. He has a concept called prior conscious thought, but it is not well defined. So basically, he is 100% retrospectivist, and that's wrong. And I admire his work enormously, but I think there's lots of evidence that there is a predictive pre-construction of experience of agency in the brain, as well as a retrospective reconstruction. And I think it's quite interesting. Probably different people are weighting pre-construction and reconstruction differently. So we already saw that schizophrenics are strongly reconstructive, whereas the controls in that study were strongly pre-constructive or predictive or prospective. So that deals with, I think, the first part of your question, I hope, a bit. But there's no doubt that we do retrospectively understand our own agency as well. I think Daniel Wegner threw the baby out with the bathwater, as we say, by overemphasizing the role of retrospection. Now, in terms of the sort of taxonomy of experience, that's quite interesting, because that's a point where I think philosophy and experimental psychology might diverge a little bit. You're right that in philosophy there has been a lot of question about whether there's a sense of control which is separate from what's called the sense of authorship, the sense that the action should be attributed to me. And that might be different from the different levels of intention. Now, in conceptual analysis, you can isolate and define what those different experiences and different levels might be, but I think the actual stream of human consciousness is often quite messy. And one important point that Daniel Dennett made was that the human mind is always reintegrating different experiences and adjusting them. So I think in philosophy, you might, on conceptual grounds, distinguish the sense of control from the sense of authorship. But I think when I press the button and make a beep, I don't perhaps really experience those as separate.
So our experience of our action is extremely synthetic. It's a composite. It's a combination of some low-level perceptual elements, like binding, some attribution, so did I do it, or did she do it, or he do it. And these are, I think, difficult to separate, particularly when you use implicit measures. So if you use an implicit measure like time perception, you're not directly measuring any single identifiable aspect of the experience. You're somehow measuring the whole thing. So that's perhaps a criticism that you could make of implicit measures, is they don't help you to sub-analyze the experience. They assume a synthetic view of the experience. I hope that helps to answer your question.
Professor, thanks for the interesting talk, very thought-provoking. And I'm wondering whether what you propose about the schizophrenics can be extended to symptoms like hallucinations and delusions. I mean, symptoms that are related to failures in recognizing mental contents that are generated inside me or by me.
Exactly. And in fact, in that study, we also administered the psychiatric questionnaire called Positive Symptom Score, which is delusions and hallucinations. And negative symptom score. So negative symptom score is all the things that you don't do if you're schizophrenic. So you don't smile or laugh. There's a whole set of behaviors which disappear. And there's a correlation between the reconstruction in the schizophrenic patients and positive symptoms. So the people who have more hallucinations and delusions show that effect more strongly. And there's no correlation at all with negative symptoms. So I think, in fact, what we say in that article is we think this is perhaps a low-level explanation of what hallucinations and delusions are. They are a failure to make the appropriate association between internal events and external events.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that. I would like to understand more clearly if one of the slides could be compared. I think if at the beginning the relation between the relation between the awareness of the action, and the effect.
How
is that? How do you achieve this data?
I'm sorry, I went rather fast, perhaps. So
yes.
It is a little bit complicated because the thing we are measuring is a difference. So we always start with a session where the person makes an action. And there is no need. So you just sit there watching the clock, and when you feel like it, you make an action. When the clock stops, you say, where was the clock when I pressed the button? So that is this red time here called the awareness of action. Now, quite interestingly, people often say that they pressed the button before the button actually moved. People often think they do things before they actually do. And if you want, you can have a discussion about that. I don't want to discuss that. And I know that it's true. There are lots of reasons why people are deluded about when they press the button. But forget about that for the moment. Forget about why. The important point is to contrast the awareness of action when there is no beep with another condition, another session of the experiment, where you make exactly the same action and you cause a beep. And in this, what we call instrumental condition, because you are the, your action is instrumental in causing the beep, we again ask, where do you think the clock was when you pressed the button? And now people say, well, it was about here. And if you look at this dashed line here, coming down, the critical inference is based on comparing the perceived time of actions which do not have beeps, that's here, with the perceived time of actions that do cause beeps. And that's what I've labeled here, the perceptual shift. And all of the actual inference, all of the logic, is based on analyzing the change in the perceived time of the action because it causes a beep, or the change in the perceived time of the beep because it was caused by the action. So we're looking at changes in the perceived time of something because action and effect came together. So that is our operational definition of agency. And just perhaps to continue a little bit, what we try to do in cognitive psychology experiments is to create two conditions, two sessions of the experiment, which are very, very similar, except in one crucial respect. And in this case, the crucial respect is the association of what I do and what happens, action B. So by looking at the difference in the perceived time of an event in this agency situation and in this non-agency situation, I can measure this perceptual shift, which is my operational definition of change in time experience.
Can I just ask a question?
Have I answered your question? Was that enough? That was just a re-explanation again.
Yes, no, you ask them when they think, they, how do you identify the awareness?
Okay, so the clock, is going round all the time. The clock hand is going round like this all the time. And the instruction to the participant is, please press this button whenever you feel like it. You choose. And then wait until the clock stops. So the clock continues, it stops at a random position, and then we say, please tell me, where was the clock when you pressed the button? Or, in another session, when you heard the beep.
And they are able to hear.
Not very well. They're bad. And lots and lots of literature in psychology shows that we are bad. So in psychology, this is what is called cross-modal synchronization. Because you're trying to synchronize, you're trying to align in time the visual stream of the clock with your own internal stream of consciousness. Yeah. And that's really bad. That's, I don't know in Brazil whether the movies are dubbed from American English into Portuguese, right? You often get a big gap between and your brain just ignores it. Your brain doesn't perceive it. So the brain is rather bad at this task. And because of that problem, we get many, 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 many trials per session. And a very important feature of psychology, or in fact, well, science generally, if you get lots and lots of data, which is a bit noisy, the average will be much less noisy. This is what's called the law of large numbers in statistics. Even if your measurement is bad, if you have many, many, many measurements, you will still understand the problem.
Just a short question based on the previous slide you showed to Sophia, the action one. What would happen if the effect be shifted to the right continuously?
Great question, very good question. We always use very short action outcome intervals, 250 milliseconds. My background is in motor physiology, sensory motor physiology, so recording from muscles and all the quick things that happen when we move. So our actions take about 100 to 500 milliseconds. So I don't understand anything long. But we have done that experiment. If you delay the beep, then the binding gets less. And that's what David Hume said. So David Hume said that temporal continuity is a very important cue for causation. And if you like, agency is a kind of causation. So this effect works, in my lab, this effect works up to about 800 milliseconds. But somebody else has done it for 4 seconds, and they claim that they get the same effect. Now, I think the basic principle, the Humean principle of linking cause and effect, that works over lots and lots and lots of timescales. So the, you know, the president of a country will, change the interest rate in the bank, and then 2 years later, the economy will go up or maybe down, and the president of the country will feel a sense of agency, maybe, about what they have done to the national economy. Over a very, very long time scale, and when you are driving a car, you're often working with control over time scales, which are like so. So I suspect that the basic principle should work for most time scales.
Because I was just thinking, but, I mean, the first line up there is like having the effect in the infinite, right, something like that. Right?
Yeah, good point.
So if it's like 4 seconds, I would imagine that you would already have decided that his awareness or whatever it would be before the action. But you're saying that someone showed that that's not the case.
Yeah, there are studies which quite convincingly show that time perception is altered even with delays of several seconds. I think it's not my data, but I think it's quite convincing. One thing, just to follow up on your question, in these experiments, we always have this constant interval 250 milliseconds. If you make this interval variable, so that you press the button and sometimes you wait 250, sometimes 400, sometimes 600, then the binding effect disappears. So it really depends on the regular, consistent relation between action and outcome, which is exactly what David Hume said. So our perceptual experience, I mean, I think David Hume was right, he just didn't measure, he wasn't a psychologist, he didn't measure perceptual experience of action, but I think he understood it.
Just a short question on that. Give a time until the patient disconnect a quadrant from the, I mean, when you change the 250 milliseconds to 4 or 6, It takes some time until he described.
That's a great question. So we've done that experiment in two ways. So in one form of the experiment, we simply randomize all of the intervals so that when the person presses the button, they don't know whether it will be 250, 450, 650. It's completely random. And then the binding effect disappears. We've also done experiments where you press the button 250 beep, 250 beep, 250 beep, 150 beep, or 350 beep. So we've done sudden changes in the interval. Right? So you learn the interval, and then it suddenly changes. And then you get something really interesting, because, for example, if you have 250, 250, 250, 150, then the person's judgment about when they heard the beep is based on when they would have heard the beep if the interval had remained the same, So they are learning to predict the delay between action and outcome, and they're using this prediction to structure their perception, which is again consistent with this idea of predictive perception.
Well, I have two questions. At some point you said about free will, if you believe free will, then you go on. So I would like to hear from you, if you believe, if you will, and if yes or no, why not? And if you don't believe it, it means for you it wouldn't play any role in explaining all of that. So.
Okay, I guess I believe it will, but I don't want to be committed to it being free. So I think there is a process which happens in the frontal part of the brain of willing, or we use this word urge, volition. I think there is a process of being about to do something. I think we have an experience of what we're about to do. I want to remain completely agnostic about whether we have free control over those processes. I think deep down in my job in a neuroscience institute, I have to be a materialist, and I believe that all of our will, all of our perception, all of our mental life is all in our brain, and as far as I know, our brain is completely deterministic. I don't think there is any indeterminacy in the brain. So I suspect I don't believe in free will, but I don't want to have that discussion. I think probably you can talk about agency, you can talk about the way that people experience their own action, while being quite agnostic or quite independent about the sort of level of, if you like, personal control or agentic control. That's a, if you like, a metaphysical issue. I think in neuroscience we don't like agent causation. We don't like mind-body causation. We reject dualism, and we reject views of the mind-body problem which deflate to dualism. And I think all of this is entirely compatible with the view that the brain gives us our subjective experience, and the brain gives us our experience of what we do. So agency is perhaps a bit... You can study agency while being neutral about the free will. In fact, I think the agency problem is more important than the free will problem. I think the sense of agency, although it's a little bit invisible, although we don't think of it very much, I think it's actually a more important component in our mental life and in our society than the question of whether there's anything like free will.
In certain questions, if only, perhaps connected with the first one, with the free will. In this concept, you can clearly explain responsibility in terms of I'm aware of my agency, in a sense. But this is one very important, of course, very important sense of responsibility, because you cause something to happen. There's another one, you know, which is a mission.
Yeah.
And you don't do anything, but you are expected to do it. You should have it.
Yeah.
So, have you thought about that? How could be that kind of explanation could help to sustain the responsibility in cases where I haven't done anything?
That's a very good question. I mean, a mission is much harder to study. It's difficult to study, and it's very difficult to study in laboratory experiments, because in psychology, psychology is often called the study of behavior. And in omission, there is no behavior, so we cannot measure anything. I mean, our experiment is wasted. So it's quite difficult to consider. I think some views in cognitive psychology consider that acting and not acting are just alternative choices at the same level of representation. So some psychologists, they might make a distinction between doing this and doing this, and they will say that is exactly the same as the distinction between doing this and doing nothing at all. So some people say that that's the right way to handle omission, is to think of not acting as a sort of action. I'm not sure I quite agree. I'm not sure I quite agree, but I don't think I have any clear comment on omission as it relates to responsibility in law.
Well, just to follow up on my first question, produce with the production of action.
Correct, correct.
So, could we say, or do you have any data, or maybe some intuition about whether the sense of agency is important to the production of action, I mean causally?
Right.
Because Danny Wagner, for instance, and I'm going to make the comparison again, he would say that conscious will, whatever, however we may want to conceptualize that, was not causally efficient. That was just an illusion. So if we consider this experience a sort of awareness, and therefore related to consciousness in some sense too, would that be causally relevant to the production of the action?
Yeah, well, that's a really tricky question, and it's basically, it's a sort of a hard problem, isn't it? So what's the added value of the fact of having a sense of agency? Why don't we all go around making actions and making leaps just like zombies? Why do we need the sense of agency? And I don't think I really know the answer. I think the sense of agency is often very, very thin. So if you're just writing an email or you're messing around on your phone, your sense of agency is not deep, profound, and metaphysically exciting. It's just your mental life. And I think probably the sense of agency is, it is important for the action you make now, only in the thin sense that you need to know enough about what you're doing that you will find out when it goes wrong.
So
failure monitoring.
So control issues.
Yeah, I think you could call that control, but I don't think it's controlling this action. I think it's working out when this action has failed, and therefore the next action should be different. And I think unless you knew what you were doing in some thin way, it would be difficult to work out that you had made a mistake. And I think you get this quite a lot when you're driving, or everything's fine, you don't have a strong sense of agency, but when, I don't know, the car makes a funny noise, or when pressing the brake does not stop the car, then boom, quickly notice. So the other point about sense of agency, I think it may be causally efficient. I mean, it may be important, it may be necessary, not for this action, but for learning about actions that I'm going to make later. So I think it's quite hard to understand. Well, I think having a sense of agency is very useful if you are learning complex sequences of actions. For example, with interacting with complex systems. So the example I always give is buying a ticket from a ticket machine in the subway, in the metro station, when you go to a new city. You look at the machine, you think, oh my god, now which button do I press? And then there's always somebody standing behind you in the queue saying, come on, come on. So I think you need to learn how to use the machine, and then when you have this sense of agency over it, then it's easy to come up to the machine and just press it. So there's something about the sense of agency which helps us to develop the fluent feeling of efficient action, in my view.
And one last question.
You said that David Hume would be happy with your findings, or about, if I understood, the evidence for the intentional binding. But I'm not sure if I understood it, even if I agree. But what do you mean by David Hume would be happy with your findings?
Well, David Hume, as I understand it, was an associationist. So he strongly believed that the mind forms associations, and he believed that the process of forming associations was, if you like, the job of the human mind. And he mentioned the idea in particular that the mind forms associations between ideas about causes and ideas about effects. That was part of his understanding, I think, of causation. Now, if I told you that you have associated the experience of the cause and of the effect
Do you think that association will make them seem closer, or will it make them seem further apart? Which would you bet, if you had to bet on that? I think you'd bet on them seeming closer. So there seems to me a very basic relation between association and perceptual integration. That's, I think, what I'm saying.
I think we have had a wonderful session, wonderful final session of this conference. Thank you so much for